day. I'm Norman Wildberger. Today we're going to talk about division, a very important subject for primary school education. And we'll have some interesting things to say about the importance, especially of long division for students. Let's start with the definition that m divided by n is k means that m is k groups of n, or k times n. So for example, if we want to know what 24 divided by 4 is, we need to know how many groups of 4 there are in 24. Well, so we can peel off groups of 4 one at a time. And now we see that there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 groups of 4 within 24. So 24 divided by 4 is 6. This shows that division is repeated subtraction. We subtract 4, then we subtract another 4, we subtract another 4 until we've exhausted the original number. That also explains why another notation for division, instead of m over n, sometimes we write m divided by n. This is another sign for division. It resembles subtraction. Here are four main laws of division. K over m plus n over m equals k plus n over m. K over m times n over l is k times n divided by m times l. K divided by m all over n is k divided by mn, the product mn. And k divided by m divided by n is k times n divided by m. So we're going to have a look at the proofs of these. I'm going to prove 1 and 4 for you, and leave 2 and 3 as exercises for you. All right, let's start with the first law. K divided by m plus n divided by m equals k plus n divided by m. So here the denominators are the same. To try to prove something like this, we'll introduce some notation to make our life easier. We'll decide that k divided by m will be called A, that n divided by m will be called B, and that k plus n divided by m will be C. So that's A, that's B, that's C, and we want to prove that A plus B equals C. What do these various things mean? This one means that k equals A times m. This one means that n equals B times m. And this one means that k plus n equals C times M. So we're just unraveling it, connecting it to the definition via multiplication. And now let's look at K plus N here. K plus N is AM plus BM here. And then the distributive law shows this can be written as A plus B times M. And on the other hand, K plus N from here is C times M. So we have this multiple of M equals this multiple of m, so a plus b times m equals c times m, so that means that a plus b has to equal c. For the fourth law, k divided by m divided by n, which is a little bit strange, is equal to k times n divided by m. We do something similar, we introduce some notation. We let m divided by n, which is the denominator here, be a. We let this entire expression be, say, b, and this expression be c. So what we want to prove is that B equals C. And now we unravel what these three things mean. This means that M equals A times N. This means, well, first of all, note that M divided by N is really A. So this is really K divided by A equals B, and we unravel it to say K equals B times A. And this tells us that K times N equals C times M. Okay, now we look at K times N from here. So here's k, and we're going to multiply it by n, b-a-n. Then we use the associative law to rewrite that as b times a-n. Then we replace the a-n with an m to get b-m. On the other hand, k-n from here is c times m. So b times m equals c times m, and so b and c are equal. And now let's say a few words about long division, a very important skill that all students should learn. I realize that in many curriculum around the world today, long division is no longer taught. That is a very serious mistake. You're essentially undermining students' ability to learn mathematics if you don't teach them how to explicitly divide one number by another. Here is a simplified way of doing long division, which is a little bit less efficient than the traditional one, but which is ideally suited for students who are not so arithmetically gifted. Let's illustrate it by dividing 203 by 7. First of all, what does it mean? We think of 203 as a string of ones, 203 ones in a row. We want to know how many sevens fit into that string. So we want to peel off one seven after another and count how many sevens we can peel off till we get the whole thing. So what we're going to do is we're going to subtract multiples of seven from it and remember how many multiples we subtracted. So first we look at 203 and ask, well, how many sevens could safely fit inside there? We want an underestimate. Well, perhaps 20 sevens fit inside. 20 times 7 is 140, so we write 140 there. When we subtract 140 from 203, we get 63. So after we've peeled off 20 sevens, there are 63 ones left. How many sevens are there in 63? Well, we remember from our multiplication tables that 7 times 9 is 63. So we peel off 9 more sevens, subtract that to get a remainder of 0. And altogether, what we've done is we've subtracted 29 sevens. And so 203 divided by 7 is 29. Let's do a slightly more complicated example. 2,166 divided by 38. So we want to know how many 38s fit inside here. We make an estimate. We guess perhaps, well, 40. Because 4 times 3 is 12, and there'll be a couple of zeros, and the 8 will make it a little bit bigger. And if we actually do the multiplication, 4 times 38 is 152, with an extra zero makes 1,520. So you may have to do that on the side, that multiplication. So 40 38s is 1,520. We subtract that from 2,166 to get 646. And now we ask, how many 38s can fit into 646? Well, let's guess 10. 10 38s is 380. When we subtract that, we get 266. How many 38s fit into 266? Well, we might guess 6. 6 times 38 is 228. You have to do that multiplication on the side. When we subtract, we get 38. And how many 38s? Well, there's one more 38 that'll fit into that, and then we'll have 0. Now, as it turns out, we've done it rather inefficiently. We've subtracted 40, and then we subtracted 10. We could have been more efficient by subtracting 50 all at once. And here we subtracted 6, and then we subtracted 1. We could have been more efficient and subtracted just 7 multiples. But it doesn't matter. There's no embarrassment in taking a few more steps. The main idea is that students should know what they're doing. You're subtracting a certain multiple of 38 from the number and keeping track of how much is left over. And you keep subtracting 38s until you've got nothing left, and then you count up how many 38s you subtracted altogether. In this case, 57. Let's do one more example where things don't quite work out so well. Let's try to divide 245 by 17. So an initial first guess might be 10. 10 times 17 is 170. We subtract, we get 75. Well, my guess, 3 17s might fit in there. 3 17s is 51. We subtract, we get 24 left over. Oh, we see we could have actually subtracted one more. Well, let's subtract one more now. So there's another 17, and we get 7. But now we're in a situation where we can't subtract any more 17s from 7. 7's too small. So we get a remainder. The division doesn't quite work out. This divided by this is not a natural number. But nevertheless, we subtracted 14 of these 17s, and we have 7 left over this remainder. So although this isn't a natural number answer, it is an important stepping stone to our next topic, that of fractions, the most challenging subject for primary school students in mathematics. I hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.